Thanks for stopping by. I'd like to preface this video by saying it is not a knitting tutorial, but it means to have something playing in the background while you work on your own project. If you're like me and really enjoy having something on while you work, sometimes you find that the content you like is very visually engaging and you're several hours in and haven't gotten nearly as far along in your project as you would have liked to. So that's where I come in. If you're new here, welcome. And if you're returning, welcome back. As you can tell by the title, we are delving in a afghan today. It is going to be square one of the Cascade Yarns Knitarati knit along, and I had signed up for the mailing list. So if you go to Cascade Yarns website and you sign up for their newsletter, then you get access to the every other week or about every 2 weeks of the 2019 Knitarati pattern. So before I left work, when we started working from home, I printed off as many as I could of each pattern, and I realized later that I had missed some of the pages, so we're just gonna start with square one today. So it is by Unjung Yun. And it is a level 3 difficulty. And if you haven't done a Knitarati by Cascades, I haven't either, this is my first one, but you basically have to buy their Cascade Superwash 220 Merino, and you choose a color scheme. So as you know, judging by the thumbnail, if you are not new here, you know I've mentioned several times how teal and these blue colorways are my favorite color scheme of all. So I was very pleased when I saw that the Knitarati pattern does come in a teal colorway. It has a olive green colorway as well as a red colorway, like a ruby type colorway. So you have a couple options to go by, and if you choose to purchase your kit through Jimmy Bean's Wool, they also have a couple other options for you as well. Or you can just make up your own colorway, and you don't have to specifically adhere to the ones that Cascade Yarns suggests. I personally bought my yarn kit from the yarn.com site. I chose to do that one because it was actually the cheapest option by supplier of the yarn. Now, if you want to support smaller business, you know, you might want to go to your local yarn shop and see if they have the colors you want. But yarn.com had all the colors I needed for the teal colorway. They were all in stock, and with the yarn.com discount for buying large numbers of or large quantity of yarn, it was a lot cheaper than either going through like Love Crafts or Jimmy Bean's or maybe another supplier. So when I bought it from yarn.com, as you can see by the thumbnail, it came in this giant tote. And so this will be one, probably the most awesome bag I've ever received from a large order of knitting. And two, it's a great place to store this afghan when I'm finally finished with it. And maybe even a good place to keep all the squares as I continue with this project. So most of the pattern, at least from what I gathered, they either range from a size 6 needle to a size 8, depending on what's going on in the square and that particular pattern maker's preference for that square. They should all be 12 by 12 inches to make one square, and the entire project is 25 squares total. So about every 2 weeks you get a new square to add to your afghan. Now I didn't join in until square 16, so I have several squares back that I need to go, but you do get access to all of the squares if you do sign up. So even if you sign up with the mailing, the newsletter later on down the line, you can still go back and get to the other PDFs of the previous square, so you can do the whole project from start to finish. So I think I just got square 18 or 19 emailed to me the last week or so. I just have another folder in my inbox that's just Knitterati. But yes, now I have all of the yarn I need. This was very much an unplanned splurge. I thought about buying the yarn later, but then I didn't think I needed to use the superwash that Cascade was advertising. But then I was like, you know, how many times have I bought my own yarn for a pattern and it either didn't come out quite the way I wanted it to, or something about it just wasn't quite right. But when I saw that the Knitterati pattern was in a teal colorway already, I'm like, why do I even have to, you know, wreck my brain thinking of another alternative to this pattern? I love teals. This will be like my blanket, my little baby that I'll knit for myself and call it like my official first blanket for Paws and Pearls. And if I love it so much, I might even like have it replace this beautiful plush Hello Kitty blanket behind me if I finish it before I die. Because if you don't know, I'm pretty slow, and I also like to juggle a million and one projects at once, so it all kind of depends on where things fall into place as we work on this project. Now, to give you a rundown too, if you're just curious, and as you knit, I'm just gonna keep rambling here, this requires 27 balls of, if you choose to go with their brand, the Cascade 220 Superwash Merino. It's 8 of the darkest shade, and then, you know what, don't quote me on that, because I think it's 8. I have my shipping. Yes, I'll tell you exactly how many of each colorway you need. All right, so yes, it is, no, I lied. So it's 7 of the darkest shade. So if you're doing the teal colorway, that is antique green. Then you need 8 of the next darkest, which is North Sea. 6 of the third darkest, or second lightest, and third, whatever, which is green blue slate, and then 4 of aqua haze, and your lightest color is, you need 2 balls, and that is the pastel turquoise. So yes, all of that I bought, and if you care to know, I'll tell you, for the 27 balls of yarn, buying them at yarn.com, the total for me was $274.74. So that is the cheapest option I found based on comparing 3 different sites. That was Love Knitting, and that was with Love Knitting, or it used to be Love Knitting. That was with Love Crafts having a discount on some of the, I don't know if it was all of the Cascades 220 Superwash or if it was some shades that I needed, but there was a sale going on. Of course, you could wait for a lower sale, but if you buy in bulk at yarn.com, I believe it goes down to about 20% off for your total purchase based on each quantity of color you buy. So like each quantity, that total cost becomes like a 20% off. So you save a lot, I think, because I believe the Jimmy Beans wool knit kit, like if you bought the whole kit of the colorway you needed, was about 300 and some odd change. And then going through Love Knitting, even with the discount, was like $295 something, and that was with their sale that they had going on. So that total price, didn't have to pay shipping, and oh no, I did. Never mind. With shipping, that was the okay, so my mistake. So the total with shipping was the $274.74. But the total cost of the yarn itself, no shipping, was $263.25. Shipping was $11.49. So it was a lot cheaper. Even with the shipping, it was cheaper than getting either the free shipping bulk from Jimmy Beans or the free shipping bulk from Love Crafts. So that is the deets on that one. So I would say if you're interested, join me. We're gonna start with square one, and I will say it's super dark and super dreary. It is 6:39. If you hear any blasts of thunder, it's been raining pretty much all week in here, and my basement's flooded as always when it rains a lot. So I haven't even had a chance to walk around and get my walking around in the basement exercise in or my laundry done because I can't go down there. Because I mean, I can put my rain boots on and go down and do laundry, but it's not worth it. Thankfully, I have enough clean items that will last me through at least a good 2 to 3 weeks more. So hopefully the water dries up before I need to go back down there. So yes, let me stop the video so that we have a fresh reel and get right into the pattern. So the pattern itself, there are a lot of patterns, and I love this because it's one square at a time, so I don't feel so overwhelmed by needing to knit an entire big blanket. The downside is, yes, there's going to be seaming. There's going to be seaming, paws and purls. You need to brace yourself for that. Whew, okay. So now that that is underway, yes, I'm going to have to seam each square to the next square, and there's a border, so that's the whole shebang. But at least I can work on it piecemeal, and it won't feel as burdensome, because if I want to skip around and do a different square when I finish one, as long as I keep them in order and make sure that I'm using the right colors per square, I can kind of do it in a modular step. It's not a lock step. You have all of the squares you need. You just pick what you do when you do it. So for the first block, it says block number one R. So I'm guessing that means there's a couple options, but and then I have block two, three, four. So maybe it's one right side, and then there's going to be one on the other side. I don't know. It just says block number 1R. R1. Yeah, 1R1. So this one I do need my... It says what you need for this particular square materials is your one ball of color A, which is the antique green, and that is the antique green. This is 86. I think 86 is, yes, 86 is antique green. So this beautiful, beautiful green. And then it says, and it feels so nice too, I need, believe this one, yes. So this is size 7 needle. So I have my US size 7, or If you're not US, it is 4.5 millimeter needles, and I need to cast on 68 stitches. And it's a 12 row pattern that is repeating. So let's cast on the 60. Oh god. Alright, now how am I gonna pull this bad boy out of here? See, this, I would think I would make it nice and easy for myself. Because we don't want any problems, right? Something feels loose. But why? There was this one, I think it was a yarn shop I was in, and there was a ball of yarn that had a little pull tab. It was like, start here. So it already made it so easy for you to figure out how to start your yarn, where to pull it from. So to save myself some drama, I'm just gonna pull this from the outside, even though I love a center pull, because it keeps everything so nice and neat. So I'll try to get some going here. But yes, I hope you guys are having a good day wherever you are. Wherever you are, whenever you see this, I've just had a good, you see this and it'll already be a week since I was off work. I've just been knitting up a storm. I have all kinds of stuff, new projects I started. And I'm just like feeling pretty good now. I kind of just have my mojo back, you know? All right, so I have to take this wrapper off, but I really don't want to because that usually means bad things are gonna happen. So I think, so the problem with me is that if I try to do a long tail, I almost always don't have enough yarn. And when I try to make sure I do have enough yarn, I usually have way too much. So I heard there is a trick that you have to just wrap it around as many times as you need to cast on, and that should be how many, how long your yarn should be. So let's try. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, and I'm not holding this tight. 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68. We'll just do a couple more just to be safe. Now this should be where I start my tail. If it's supposed to be the way that I remember it. But we'll see. We're gonna find out. Oop. Gotta actually make it happen though. There we go. Let me know, do you prefer a long tail? Or do you prefer, oh my lord. Oh, my phone is giving me an emergency warning saying, emergency alert, severe flash flooding in this area until 10:15. Avoid flooded areas. That's everywhere over here. Everywhere floods where I live during the heavy rains. And that's like one thing that I miss about back home. Yes, I lived in the Pacific Northwest. Yes, we got rain, but it was temporary. You got a drizzle here, a drizzle there, a sprinkle here, a little mist here, and it'd go away. But here in the Midwest, when it rains, it's buckets and buckets, and it never stops. And everything's flooded, roads are closed, power lines are down, squishy yards, you know, it's just horrible when it rains really bad in the Midwest. It's so flat. But in the Pacific Northwest, there are hills, there's drainage, there's natural landscape that's good at absorbing lots of rain. I didn't have to buy rain boots. Swear to goodness to you, I didn't have to buy rain boots until I moved to the Midwest. There weren't any crazy puddles where I lived when I was growing up, so it wasn't until I moved out here that I needed rain boots. Craziness. Anyway, so we, oh, okay. Sleeves coming off. But yes, I was gonna ask you guys what your favorite cast on is. I love long tail, but it messes me up. So I prefer to just do a regular knit cast on so I know exactly how many stitches I need, how much yarn I need, and I don't have any long loopy things hanging off and stuff. So that's me. Even a cable cast on's fine, as long as I start with my first stitch being the one that I knit into. That is fine with me. But let me know what your favorite is. Some patterns tell you what you need to do anyway. Alright, but this one does not. It just says cast on. And even in the notes, it doesn't say. Oh yeah, and then some of these patterns give you the written and the chart form. I want to say they all give you both, but honestly, I've only been going from the written one, though I should learn how to do chart, but for a lot of these things, I'm like, I don't want to risk it. Maybe for something just like a fun little frivolous project, but most of these are made with purpose. So I don't want to mess up by misreading my chart. So I'd rather go off of the written one. So let's get my extra tail. Oh, let me turn my slip the other way. Alright, so we cast on 68. We have our first one. So I'll just do this a few times and then count them up and hope I got what I needed. And I'm not doing it too tight because you're not supposed to cast on too tight, and I tend to knit a little bit tight, and I get to block each block, and I think I'll do that as I go. so that I have them all ready when it's time to sew them together. But yeah, I've been seeing this Knitterati pattern advertised on my Facebook timeline. I've seen it on Instagram, and I'm just like, huh, maybe. But it wasn't until I looked closer at the little squares that I'm like, ooh, like, I really like those colors. And all of the pattern samples are displayed in the teal colorway as well, so I like that. Yes, I think after I knit with you guys, I'm probably just gonna curl up on the couch and work on this other project I have that I would like to get some more progress on. So I'm not pulling tight, I'm just making sure that the yarn comes up to the needle. And that's it. Just so it touches. I think my neighbor is playing fetch in the house with her dog. So I hear thumping, I hear barking. And sometimes they do that. But because their basement is like my basement, can't do it in the basement right now. I'm kind of curious, like, what kind of setup they have if they can do that in the house. See, how far am I? Probably not far. Let's see. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30, 32, 34, 36, 37. Yep. Okay. So I still have quite a ways to go. Just keep adding some more. And this is fine because even if I add too many, I can take some away at this point, but it's when I start running out of yarn that we have a problem. But this is cool. I kind of like the long tail, just like, it seems like magic. It's like, okay, I'm gonna make a slingshot, and then who figured out this is how you need to run it through your fingers to get it to stick on your needle the right way? Like that. That's pretty cool. So props to the inventors of knitting. And all of the science that goes into making something. Honestly, the more I think about how much time it's gonna take to make this, I might not even use this blanket. I'm almost like, I'm just gonna pin it on my wall. I'm gonna get it framed or something. It's gonna become like this tapestry type memorial of my first like giant blanket that I make for myself. We'll see. Oh, bollocks. I think I'm making my tail too long. I don't want to waste my yarn. It's too expensive. We'll see. But yes, it's a spring. It's a day like this and I'm like, oh, it would be the perfect day to curl up in bed and just sit in bed and sleep, because the rain makes me sleepy. Just hearing it beating the heck out of my poor, poor roof is like, oh, peaceful. Let me do a couple more and then I'll count up where we are. Alright, let's see. Got a nice little bit here, so we'll start at the beginning again. And I'll do 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30, 32, 34, 36, 38, 40, 42, 44, 46, 48, 50, 52, 54, 56, 58, 60, 62, 64, 66, 68, okay. So, as I was worried, I had way, look at this, look at all that I have left. Ugh. I'm very tempted to just like start. This isn't terrible waste, but it's still at least, you know, one little bit left. So let me do one more count just to make sure, because we all know that I could easily mess this up right now. So let me count one more time to make sure that I have 68 stitches on my cast on, and then we will begin. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30, 32, 34, 36, 38, 40, 42, 44, 46, 48, 50, 52, 54, 56, 58, 60, 62, 64, 66, and 68. All right, so we definitely have what we need. Now let me see. Slip one, knit wise, cool. I see they start me out easy. Where the heck is my, oh, it was on my lap. All right, let me look at this again, make sure. Oh yeah, and I need to mark that this is the right side of my work. So we will slip as asked. And I would say I'd hold this double stranded to hide my tail, but it'll make it thicker. We'll do it. We'll just do it for the first one. Just a couple, right? And what else? Okay. This one's easy enough. Knit to the end. Cool, cool, cool. And I'm making sure not to pull too tight because I know I am a tight knitter and I don't want to be getting off on the wrong foot with this project. But yes, I'm guessing they start you out a little easy. Well, honestly, every designer is probably going to have their own preference for what kind of pattern they want to do for a square. But at least the first square is like not too bad. It's got some variation, but because I don't need any extra notions, like I think it's like the one that just came out, you need to have a cable needle and stuff. So I was like, well, okay, it's a square. It's only enough to make a foot of work, so it's not going to be too bad. You just got to get through a little bit of it. So that does help. But I'll be excited to see what this looks like when I'm actually done with it. Okay, so now that I've knit through a little bit, I'm going to drop my tail yarn and just keep going with the working yarn for the rest of the row. And then when I do the wrong side, that'll give me a little more to work with, and then I'll clip a little stitch marker on the right side so I know where I should be looking. But I imagine, because it looks like the wrong side is purling anyway, maybe it'll be easy to tell. I had to look a little further down to see. So I can't remember what the pattern looks like, honestly. I only printed out the chart itself to save on ink, so I didn't go through and print what the pattern should look like too, just the instructions. But this is going to be its own series too, because I'm going to be working on this one a long time. And just like with the Jolie Mimi cardigan, there are going to be several videos you see of me working on the different squares and multiple times where I'm probably working on the same square just to get through this project. So this will be like an ongoing one. Man, that rain is coming down, something fierce out there. And I do have my wonky stitch counter, so I just did row one. So I keep track of what I'm up to over here. Cool. So now, This is gonna be weird. Let me see. Now I'm confused, because it says, like, this is a square, right? But it says for row three, okay, so I'm looking ahead. Row three, it's like knit. Then it says turn. Hard to believe that it took me so long just to cast on and knit my first row, but after looking at the pattern some more, I was surprisingly confused by what's ahead after the second row, but I spoke aloud and realized that you're no longer watching me or listening to me because the camera stopped. As per usual, it wouldn't be a Paws and Pearls video if there was something wrong with the production, correct? So I am still on row two. I spent some time looking at the pattern and I spoke aloud to announce my confusion with it wanting me to turn my work mid-row and repeatedly turn it in the same row till I finish through the end of it. So I'm just gonna finish row two, and if we're lucky, we can try row three together and see what happens with that. But I'm a little confused by what it's asking me to do. I want to see, like I mentioned, the camera may have cut out when I was talking about it, but I did say I opted not to print the image of the pattern when I was printing these at work because I wanted to save on paper and ink, so I just went with the instructions. So I have no idea what this square is supposed to look like right now. I mean, I could obviously just pick up my phone and go into my email and look at the pattern again, but where's the fun in that? Let's just fly by the seat of our pants together and do this pretty much blindly. Basically, knitting this square one with only the instructions as our guide and no image. And we'll see later how close I am to the example, the sample piece, because oh yeah, if you go to the Jimmy Bean site for this pattern, they do have tutorials. They have some YouTube videos of working each square. So if you feel like you want to do this one and need some help, the tutorials are there for you. Now, am I going to look at it? Maybe, eventually, but right now I just want to knit. I don't want to go and get any help quite yet. I think I'm at the early enough stage where a little bit of my normal confusion is okay. But if the pattern starts looking really wonky, then I will seek some assistance from the professionals. But I think it's just getting the concept down of what it is I need to do, and then the rest will follow. At least that's what I'm hoping anyway. So if I finish this row two, and there is a right side and a wrong side, so I am working the wrong side right now, and I think when I finish row three, I will put my stitch clip in the front so I know that the right side is the side with the little clip on it. And I'm making sure not to knit super tight so that everything kind of feathers out, becomes the square it was meant to be. All right, so we just finished row two. So I'll click my progress stitch row counter. All right, so now here's where it gets weird. Number row three. So we'll slip one, knit seven, all right. Two, three, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and then turn. And then slip one, yarn in front, whoop, and then knit three. Oh my gosh. One, two, three. Then turn. Heck. This does not make any sense. Ugh. Okay, now I'm really stuck. Okay, yes. Okay, maybe I do need that tutorial. One moment. After watching the YouTube video, I am probably just as confused as I was when I tried to do it myself, but I have a little bit more of a visual perspective of what it is that I'm doing. So I did see the pattern, and it's more like a popcorn, kind of like a bobble pattern, but it's like a faux bobble. It's not really a fully raised bit, but there is a bit of garter that's going against the grain, kind of, that's creating this bubble effect. So that is repeating through the whole pattern, and I'm turning my work to knit over what I just knit previously, which is creating that raised effect. And after watching the tutorial, I can see that the instructor had her working yarn on the needle that was like active instead of on the one that you're knitting into, which was what threw me off when I looked at it. So it looks like I'm in the right place, like where I should be. But it's definitely something that requires a lot more concentration than I'm used to because this is nothing I've ever done before. And I could say that about a lot of different patterns I've had, but let me, now that I've explained what it is I'm supposed to do, I'm going to knit through those rows and then show you what it is that I'm actually trying to explain verbally. At least if I do this right, I should be able to show you what I mean. This camera is about to run out of juice and the other one is still charging, so we're in a bit of a predicament right now. But I did want to let you know that I got through the first 7 rows, and if you can't see it right now, there is a little bit of a bobble effect going on. Probably still can't see it this far away, but I'll insert a picture right here of what the pattern's supposed to look like when this square one is done. So this is going to be the Knitterati series with the Cascade Yarn wool and pattern duo. And once again, thank you so much for stopping by, and I'll catch you in the next one. Bye!